Something we need all the time in games is to create a variable, and when we change the value, we want something else to change. Like, we want the character's material to update to reflect the color. We might want that to work in the editor and in the game for fast development and prototyping purposes. But also imagine you have mobs in the game and they have a little health bar above them, and when they take damage, their health goes down, and you want to reflect that on the health bar. To do that, you can use something called a setter function. This is what we'll see in this video. Like all our Godot 4 examples, the code in this video is free and open source. You can go find the source demos and explore them in the description below. This video is sponsored by Godot game devs like you who invest in learning with GDQuest. Remember, for a limited time, you can pre-order our Godot 4 courses below launch price. They're rolling out starting January 30, 2024 on GD School, our own new learning platform. There are two different ways to bind a setter or getter function to a property. The first one is you define your variable as usual, then you add a colon and set equals, followed by a reference to the function to call when changing the property. If you want both a setter and getter, then you need first to do this for set, then you insert a comma, and finally you do the same for get with get equals name of the getter function. Note that you don't have to do this on multiple lines, you can do it all on a single line if you prefer. This syntax is fine and pretty similar to what you would do in lots of programming languages, that is, assigning setter functions. But if your code is pretty long, this means that you need to control click and jump around your code to see what the setters and getters of your properties are doing, unless you decide to mix variables and functions. There's a second syntax that you can use that allows you to have the function code right next to your property. It works like this. Like before, you define a variable, and at the end of the line, you add a colon. Then you must add a line return. If you try to put everything in line, it's not going to work because you're essentially defining functions with the set and get keywords. So you write set followed by the name of a function parameter in parentheses. So it's kind of a different way of defining setter functions. And inside of that, after the colon, you can define your function body as usual. And it's a similar thing for the get function. You write get colon and then your getter functions code. This syntax is a bit more awkward. The main advantage is that the setter and getter instructions are right next to your property. In this example, I have a scene representing a character, and I want to have a health bar, health management on the character, and perhaps some label for display, and I want the bar to move alongside the character. So when the character takes damage, the health goes down, and this is reflected in the attached user interface. Imagine a little unit going around your game, or some mobs that you can fight, and you have health bars shown at all times above them. A simple way to do that in Godot is to have the bits of UI attached to the characters in the same scenes or easy access in code, and to use setter functions for the health property. So let me show you what I mean. I just open the code, and there I have two properties. The first one, max health, that has a setter, and the other one, the health, that has both a setter and getter for illustrating how to use getters. So we've seen the syntax already. Now let's look at the code, right? I need a couple of instructions when changing the max health. The first thing is I want to change the max health property, but on top of that, I need to change the maximum value of my progress bar that I use as a life bar. And I also want to heal the character by adding the increase in maximum health. So I can do all that by using one setter function. So this is one concrete use case. I have a slightly more complex and interesting ones when setting the health variable. So there are two things. If the new health is lower than the current, then it means that the character took damage, so I can play the hurt animation. On top of that, I want to, you know, clamp the health value so it shouldn't go beyond max health if I'm firing a healing spell or using a potion. And if the character takes a critical hit that would take the health in the negative, I want to make sure that it doesn't go below zero. So the clamp function allows me to do that. And then in that same function, I can start tween animations. So here I'm animating the progress bar value. So when I run the scene and click, this is what is causing the bar to empty gradually. And on top of that, you can see the health label animates. And for that, I'm using the tween.tween method function that allows me to write a lambda function, which you can learn about in our dedicated video, and to animate the text of the label node. Finally, getter functions, to be honest, I very rarely use. These allow you to prevent people from directly reading a value from a variable, but instead to return another value that's encapsulated, hidden somewhere. So a typical way you would use that is like this. You would write a function to get health in this case, and return another variable that people working with your code don't have access to. And you would probably do the same for the setter function to make sure that the variable doesn't get written to directly. This is pretty uncommon though, I think, in GDScript or in languages like Python. It might be more common in languages like Java. So I think this is not something you will see used a lot in the Godot community. Let's break down the second example that allows us to recolor the character using a color picker in the inspector or in the running game. If I open the script, you'll see that it's much simpler than the previous example, actually. We export a variable named color and set it to a color. Because of the use of the type inference, Godot knows that we want a color picker for this one. So this is why we get this widget in the inspector. Then this variable has a setter and getter associated with it using the second syntax. So we go to the next line, write set, and a parameter name in parentheses. We assign the value to the color variable, and then we assign that color to the material attached to the character, the one we use to control the color. And it's this simple. Now this material, the body material, is saved on our disk. So if I go to the file system in the bottom left, you can see it highlighted right there. Godot body recolor material. I can open it individually in the inspector. It's assigned to my character, and you can see that the color of the character matches. So if I change the color on the material, it also works. But by exporting a variable and changing the material color, we get this nice widget in the inspector such that we don't need to go open the scene and select the character and mess with the materials and dive into the properties of the scene. Now, whenever we make an instance of Godot here, we can change the color on the fly thanks to this little script. This is a really powerful trick. You can save a resource like a material to the hard drive. And the way you would do that, if I reopen the Godot skin and select the character, you know, you might create material here, and then you can right click on it and go to save. And this will allow you to save the resource to the disk. So then instead of being embedded in the scene file, it's going to be a separate file on your hard drive. And once you've done that, in your code, you can control, click and drag the resource to add this preload statement, right? And you can shorten the path to use a relative path as well as we're doing here. And once you've loaded that, the advantage is you can just change the properties of this resource on the fly in your code, and anything using this resource will update accordingly. And by the way, this is here in the ready function that we assign this body material to the GoBot model. So we use the function setSurfaceOverrideMaterial, which allows you to assign a material that overrides the default to one of the slots of a mesh. Finally, this updates in the editor, and you might be wondering how to achieve that and not only have it update in the game. To do that, we use the tool mode in Godot, @tool. This allows your script to run directly in the editor. Now, an important note about that. Here we are extending another script that controls the animation tree of the character. And so if you use the tool mode in an inherited script, you'll also need to go open the parent script, and it must use the tool mode. Then, when you use tool mode, all of the code you see here by default will run in the editor. So you need to add conditions if some of the code you don't want to run in the editor. So this is something we've done here by going to the ready function. We can see that we use engine.isEditorHint. This function will return true if the script is running in the editor and return false when the script is running in the game. So you can see at the top of the ready function, we say if we are running from the editor, we return from the function and we avoid connecting those two timer signals. Finally, we also deactivate the animation tree while running in the editor because the animation tree has a tendency to change the properties of the scene. And very importantly, when using the tool mode, all the properties that you change, all the variables that you animate and all, these will persist when you save the scene. So you want to make sure that the animations and those kinds of things are turned off or the character animation is set to reset when running in the editor. Subscribe to get more videos like these and be sure to join our Discord community. It's a great place to give and get help from fellow Godot users. You'll find a link in the description.